I could take and turns that I could make. That they just couldn't, they couldn't possibly know where I'm going.
We were trying to purchase drugs from everybody. We were trying to entwine everybody into it. So they beep the horn, they pull over, I pull over, I get in the back of their car. It was brown, it was chunky, it was all, I said, oh, really? I webbed my finger, I stuck my finger in it, and I put it in my mouth, because I saw that on TV somewhere, and I've never tasted something so disgusting in my life. And they looked at me, like, what is this moron doing? And I went, ugh. You know, I didn't know that's what you were supposed to do with coke, not heroin. I was told by DEA that there was word on the street that the Country Boys were gonna hit Nicky.
Frank Lucas, the Country Boys. They came up from South Carolina. Rumor has it he had this guy who was shipping this thing over here in coffins from Vietnam. And it was like primo material. They had to pay a tax. Okay, you know, you got goods, but you don't have no real estate. You know, we own all the real estate in the Harlem and the Bronx.
Frank got a big mouth. He sound country, and he sound ignorant. Yeah, I'm gonna say, I can hear Sam say, yeah, shit, I'll kill that motherfucker, shit. Yeah, shit, yeah. I don't give a fuck. And the reason why they were called the Country Boys, because that's what they were. They were country guys, and they acted country, and they dressed country. If you said to one of them, well, what does it mean when they say dress to your left? They wouldn't know what the fuck you mean. It means pull your dick to your left. If the guy's gonna measure you for your pants, you dress to the left. What does that mean, Frank? He wouldn't know what the fuck they was talking about. Because he never had shit like that made, you know? He's off the rack. He would not dare to offend me to the extent of telling somebody that he was gonna put a contract on me.
Being white is perhaps the most dangerous thing that an agent can do on this job. Because if you're discovered, either one of two things, they're going to think you're either you could be an informant, and that's big time trouble where they could whack you right in the spot.
When Nicky looked at you, he looked through you. One time, this guy walked up to me and said, Nicky wants to see you. There was nothing I could do. I mean, I had to go see him. But when I walked in that room, is somebody gonna grab me from behind, cut my throat, throw me on the floor, shoot me in the head? So my knees got very weak. It was probably a 10, 12 yard walk that lasted about 3 hours in my mind. When I walked in the room, he looked at me, he tilted his head, he picked up a tinfoil and said, you want some coke? I said, nah, I don't want no coke. And everybody started laughing. When I heard the laughter, it broke the ice.
Geronimo, he wasn't afraid. But I know for a fact that Barnes would kill the informants in a minute. And he'd take out insurance policy killings, which would just kill somebody because he might be an informant.
In the drug business, if you're not willing to terminate, you won't survive. It's a simple equation, because you'll see as you evolve, you'll begin to see that if you aren't willing to terminate, you might yourself be terminated. So you have to use violence as a means to resolve certain problems. That's the way this game was played, and it's always good to play that way. And if you don't see it, you won't survive. Anybody who's in powder, who's not willing to terminate, will be terminated.
There was no regret. It was really business. It was work. And I say work, I'm using the term that he would have and did use. They saw that as a business necessity to eliminate a danger of law enforcement, to eliminate potential witnesses who would threaten the organization. There was no compunctions about committing murder.
Even the chainsaw, as bizarre as it may seem, that was a hit that was contractual obligation.
I think as cold-hearted as it is, it's a means to an end. We're talking about two different systems of values, and if you turn on television at night and you see a picture of a young person who was a suicide bomber, in your mind, it's incomprehensible why anyone could do that. But to those people within that system of values, that's totally acceptable.
There was a birthday party that we, through informants, we got wind that he was throwing himself a birthday party.
I threw Nick a big party at the Time of Life building in the street. That's all you could hear about. Did you get an invitation to Nick's party? You know, so if you didn't get one, you was just like outcast, you know. I really liked it also because it was very secure. They had two places that I could have his bodyguards that they could check for weapons, because I didn't want any weapons in there. And I didn't want the police slipping in there, you know, undercover police slipping in there.
We decided what we would do is, you know, obviously we would want to see who all his Confederates were, and we would want to see them together. We decided that we would infiltrate the party if we could, and we would photo and identify all the different players that would come and go to this very, very, what we expected to be a very lavish party.
In the middle of the party, I mean, it's like 3 o'clock in the morning now, and somebody comes upstairs, so they don't know what's going on. It was like, Mrs. Barnes, do you know that there's a lot of federal agents downstairs looking at everybody's cars and taking down license plates?
It became a little bit of a legend because every waiter in the place seemed to be talking into his tray.
We actually had an undercover officer pose as a maitre d' at the party, where he was able to actually observe, you know, the tributes that were given to Nicky Barnes. I mean, there were people that actually came up to him and handed him paper bags filled with cash. He was an arrogant drug dealer that needed to be taken down.
God bless America. We sitting there at all our birthday parties because we had freedoms here that we wouldn't have anywhere else. And we exploited them. But what we wanted to do was get involved with a business to surface a substantial amount of clean money. And this was the subject matter of periodic council meetings among us.
I think it's every gangster's dream to ultimately envision himself going, quote unquote, legit. And they have fancies about their kids going to prep schools, and one day their kid was going to be a senator and this and that.
I remember him saying that he felt closer to getting out of the game than he had ever felt at that time because he was getting money from his investments. I remember him talking about that. That all that stuff he wanted to be the girls one day.
He was getting kilos by the hundreds from Madonna. That whole part of the operation, which brought in income, was so finely tuned that we were able to step away from that and look beyond it to our broader vision. And that's when it was at its peak. I was asked to do a piece on him. I said, of course I would, you know, because
he seemed juicy because he stood there and went like this to everybody. Every gang, you know, the Italian crime, the Jewish crime, the Irish, as they came through, the dynamic was you were a criminal, you killed people, you made money, you invested in legitimate businesses, and you became a CEO.
I recall getting a phone call from a fellow by the name of Fred Ferretti, and he said, David, we're going to put an article in the Times, and this will be the front page picture. 2 days after that, I get a call from a fellow who introduces himself as A.M. Rosenthal. He says, my name is A.M. Rose, and I said, perhaps you don't understand. I can't get involved in this posing Barnes for a picture. He said, no, Mr. Brightbow, perhaps you don't understand. If I don't get him posed for a picture the way you want, he said, I'm going to put that picture when he was arrested in the middle of the night, and it was for the murder, and it's got a number across his chest, and he looks like he ate the victim's eyes. I'm going to put that on the front page of the New York Times. He said, what time will your photographer be here?
He said, well, just bring me something down to the attorney's office to put on. So I bought him this red, white, and blue tie. Because, you know, usually when they put an African-American on a cover with a mugshot, you know, you just think guilty already, you know.
Well, I guess I kind of felt a little swell-headed about it. But at the same time, I was kind of praying in my heart of hearts that the red, white, and blue tie might have had a little bit more significance than the name Mr. Untouchable.
I remember reading the New York Times and opening up the magazine, and there was this cocky, flamboyant, look at me, I am Mr. Untouchable.
When I saw the article, I looked at it, I said, oh, shit.
Oh, man, that was turmoil then.
Whatever our problems was before, they have quadrupled.
You gotta follow the rules. I mean, the cop's job is to lock us up, and our job is not to get locked up. But you don't go na-na-na-na-na to stand up there in the front of the New York Times with Mr. Untouchable. Yo, what, are you fucking crazy? What are you doing?
I came into the office on Monday morning, and around 8 o'clock in the morning, the phone rang. And it was Griffin Bell, who was the United States Attorney General at the time. And he said to me something to the effect that he had just come back from a cabinet meeting. And he said that President Carter had read this article. And he said, this is the most important case in the United States today.
The letter that President Carter sent a month or so later, even though it was a nicely written letter, I took that to mean, don't screw it up.
When me and G got hopping, when we started rolling, I mean, we were like the White Knights of Harlem, man.
We didn't push that we wanted to meet Nicky Faison and do a hand-to-hand. We knew that was stupid. We weren't going to do that. But we did know that he was the head of the organization, and we wanted to deal with his people.
I told Wally, we'll tell your people, you know, that not only can I, you know, do business with them on my level in terms of buying dope for them, but I could do services for them. Variety of different services, whatever they need. Money laundering, I got many connections still in New York. I do it myself. So Wally dropped that on Jazz, and I guess Jazz wanted to test the waters. You know, he wanted to test the waters, so he went for it.
Running a bunch of small businesses, I accumulated a lot of small cash, and I just tried to reduce the cash. You know, I didn't want to report it, didn't want to put it in a bank account or whatever the case may be. I was trying to reduce the quantity of cash. And I needed somebody to do this with. Somebody mentioned the fact that Wally had somebody that did this, and that person that they recommended was a DEA agent.
Wally is a fucking asshole. I mean, nobody goes to him for anything. How could Jazz even go to this guy for anything except that he was so motherfucking obsessed was trying to make himself look self-sufficient, but he wasn't independent of me.
Jazz commits to do another laundry, another money wash with us. And me and Geronimo go upstairs. There's Jazz, there's the man, you know, sweet, nicely dressed, big medallion studded with diamonds, Jazz right across, you know, the front of the medal, you know.
I really wasn't concerned who he was, you know, because I wasn't doing anything that required me to be worried. I'm just changing small bills to big bills. I mean, it's a simple transaction.
I pretty much rolled the dice, and I told him, listen, Jazz, up until now, you know, I've done things with your people, and the shit hasn't come back right. You know, I did an eighth with Petey, you know, for $8,000. The fucking shit fucking sucked.
All I'm doing is saying to me, I'm trying to change this money. He's constantly, you know, trying to interject, you know, talking about drugs, man. I'm like, yeah, huh? And I'm trying to complete this transaction.
All Jazz had to say at that point was, what the fuck you talking about? I don't know these fucking people.
You had them check with me, man. Tell them, Geronimo will come out Friday night and I'll talk to them.
But he went with it. He went with it. Again, big one, big evidence on tape. Plans were laid, the logistics were laid out. We had this phenomenal assembly of state troopers, police officers, federal agencies. You know, it's gonna be a major sweep.
I saw the surveillance. They had me surrounded. So when I came back out of the bar after I dropped off my gun, they arrested me.
When Nick got arrested, they could not get him on possession. They got him what they called continual criminal enterprise that had just came into law.
The case that they made against me, they had to manufacture. I'm saying that they didn't have a case against me. I'm not saying, we had flooded Harlem with drugs, Harlem, the Bronx, and Brooklyn. I'm not talking about that, you know. But it was done masterfully enough so that we were beyond just their surveillance. I didn't even know Diaz.
While there were problems with virtually every piece of evidence that we had such a variety, a matrix, if you will, to go back to the organization, we had proof that implicated each and every member in the organization and fit in with what Wally Fisher had told us was the relationship among all the folks from Nicky on down.
The government bent over backwards to make it be Nicky Barnes's case, and they were willing to take whatever steps are necessary.
The focus was, we are targeting Barnes because he was Mr. Untouchable.
That trial was the first anonymous jury in the history of the United States. I said, Judge, how you can pick a jury if you don't know what their names, addresses are, if you don't know what religion they are, if you don't know what kind of community they come from, you don't know what their economic background is?
The trial was bullshit, huh? They put 15 people on trial in a major drug conspiracy that half of them didn't know the other half.
A big thing was that they had these just mountains of electronic surveillance tapes and telephone taps and tap this and so-and-so and informers who had wires on them. A whole lot of shit that they had. But nothing with Nicky Barnes on it. Nothing.
You have to understand, you're not going to find Nicky Barnes out on the street selling drugs any more than you would expect to find the chairman of General Motors on the assembly line making cars.
That's what we did every day. It became a normal part of life. We got up in the morning, we got dressed, and we went to trial.
They had a star witness that we didn't know anything about. And when she got up on the stand, that was it. You know, she confirmed the continual criminal enterprise, and it just was not good. And then you got the president saying, you know, I want him off the street.
Right in the middle of the trial, after the seventh game of the World Series, and Reggie Jackson won the game with a home run, his third home run. And Jimmy Breslin, a columnist for the New York Daily News, wrote a column the next day describing a conversation he had after the game. There was a little black kid from Harlem, maybe 8 or 9 years old. And Breslin had said to him, well, I guess your hero is Reggie Jackson, right? The kid said, no, no, my hero is Mickey Barnes.
When I got word that we had a verdict, I got in an elevator and I'm coming down, and at some point, Bob Fisk got on the elevator, and we're getting ready to walk over to the courtroom. And I said to myself, Bob seems very cool, very calm. I don't feel like that. And then Bob turned to me, he said, gee, I wonder what the jury wants to know. I wonder what their note says. And I looked at him, I said, Bob, it's not a note, it's a verdict.
Leroy Nicky Barnes was perhaps Harlem's and one of the country's biggest drug dealers. He sported the fur coats and fancy cars that marked his success. At 45, he was known as the untouchable because the law couldn't seem to lay a hand on him. But the day, he was sentenced to life in prison.
When the conviction comes down, your mind goes to fast forward, and you immediately fast forward to the appeal process. The business plan, in the event that I was convicted, was that we were going to keep our investments going, and we were going to keep powder coming in, and we were going to maintain the same type of discipline that we had when we were all together.
I knew that I had to be strong. I had my girls, and I had to keep hold of what he had. Nick is not here, you know, but we still here, you know. So, you know, business as usual. But nobody stood behind me with that. And the longer he was away, the more he saw or started hearing things in the street that he didn't like.
I'm in the joint. I got life with no motherfucking parole. And I'm still doing shit for these niggas, man. And they couldn't even honor that. Why am I sending out supply after supply, and they're sitting out there fucking up money, buying bad loads of shit? I think that probably the breakdown began with guys' obsession to fill my shoes. King is dead, but long live the king, because I'm the new king.
There was a lot of chaos. It was a whole different game, especially when crack came on the scene. It was a lot more volatile. It was a lot more scary than to be out.
The Barnes organization defended those locations, and they shot a lot of people.
The game got funky. You know, it got just that funky. Like a nightmare, from a dream to a nightmare.
One day I went down to David Breitbart's office, and I was looking at it, and I saw a piece of paper, and it said, pick up Nick's jewelry from Chemeca. I found out that she was, you know, Nick's little girlfriend.
She had heard about Chemeca, and she was pissed. She was really pissed.
she changed her name to Shameka Barnes, that's what I was really angry about. Because I didn't know whether, okay, were you guys so tight that you gave her your last name? He kept lying, and I knew he was lying. It changed my feelings for him a great deal.
Thelma. Thelma was disloyal to me. So I called one of my buddies, you know. And he said, yeah, he said, Nick, he said, she was on 7th Avenue. In your Mercedes, in your white Mercedes. And he said, I didn't even see him. They called me to the car. He said, Tito called me to the car because he wanted me to see that he had your woman. Anyhow, Thelma got involved with this character, and she began to disregard what were her duties to me.
Nick knew the legitimate reason why I got angry was because of Shameka, but he will never say that part. You know, he'll never say, well, you know, when she found out about Shameka, she got upset and, you know, so she turned to someone else. That would be like too close to the truth.
He had a girlfriend. She was a very attractive woman. He really cared about her. It was his woman. And Guy Fisher, you know, there's an old saying, there's a lot of fish in the sea. You know, you don't have to go after my girl. And he did. And when the word got back to Nicky, that was something that alienated him about Guy.
We bought the Apollo, and Guy was handling all of the renovation and opening of the Apollo. And I'm hearing stories about him sitting up in the balcony with my woman, kissing on my woman. Look at that guy. I'm thinking this faggot ass motherfucker, you know, but he got a bone with my woman. So I'm saying to myself, like, what does that mean, nigga, that you did it? You did that to her. Guy put himself in the position of dictating policy to me. I'm the one who dictated the policy, not he. You don't fuck with the king's woman. You can be a womanizer all you want, you know, but you don't violate the rules. And when he violated them, he had to pay. I said to Frank, I want you to lay down Tito and I want Guy in the ground. I want him horizontal, man. That's what I want done. And he said, well, I'm gonna get it done. So anyhow, he's not doing anything. And as I'm looking at it, I know why he's not doing anything. The guys began to realize that I wasn't getting out. I'm thinking to myself, and I remember saying to myself, I can't run it. But I sure could wreck that motherfucker, man. I can't run it, but I could wreck it.
Called by Jim Moss, my unit chief, to join him in Bill Tendy's office, and was told that Barnes contacted Bill Tendy, and either Bill played for or gave me an audio tape that he had made of a conversation he had had with Barnes.
Now, go ahead, tell me what it is you have in mind.
In general, yeah, a few friends of mine. Former friends of mine that were just...
I can't hear you very well.
They were a couple of friends of mine that were supposed to be doing things for me, you know?
Yeah.
And they're doing things against me, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I have no way to reach out to get to them, and I want to get back at them, really.
Mm-hmm.
That's my primary reason.
I listened to that tape and tried to understand what would he hope to gain by cooperating, because there was very little we could actually offer him in the way of a reward or an inducement. Bill said, it's always the same. It's revenge, revenge, revenge.
Took my money. You got my honey.
Nick went about setting me up, which was another thing that really hurt. They extradited me back to New York. And I'm sitting there watching television, and it's a flash that Leroy Nicky Barnes has turned state's evidence. This person's been arrested, that person, this person, that person, that person. And the wife of his two children. And
9 former associates of Harlem drug king Leroy Nicky Barnes charged today with narcotics conspiracy and 6 murders. As Jim Van Sickle learned, the man behind the charges is none other than Barnes himself.
When I heard that he flipped, I was shocked and surprised, because I had a great deal of respect for this guy, as did everyone I knew. So it did come as a major, major surprise. It was almost unbelievable.
He put something beautiful together, and he made us men, and people looked up and respected us. In all reality, he was a coward. I mean, I can say that from my heart.
I don't think he did it because he thought he'd get a deal. I went to bat for him. The U.S. attorney at the time, Rudy Giuliani, went to bat for him. But he had to know that was not likely to be in the cards for him.
If Nick would have flipped right away because he didn't want to go to jail, I think I would have been surprised, because he was the John Gotti before John Gotti. He was the gangster. He was the man, you know. But when I found out why he did it, you want to talk about the word of don't rat? Well, that's one thing that's real strong, but fucking payback and revenge is even stronger.
Just before the trial, Shemeca was murdered.
Well, she was in this bar up on Broadway and Amsterdam, where everybody used to hang out. Two guys come in, and they walk up to her and shoot her in the head.
Shemeca went down. They did it to intimidate me, you know, in hoping that I would retract whatever my testimony, or that I would be reluctant to maybe testify at a trial.
Nicky Barnes was once New York's biggest heroin dealer, heading up an alleged 7-man drug ring called the Council. Now he is the government's star witness, recently testifying in court and at a presidential commission accusing his former partners of drug conspiracy and murder.
When the time arrived for me to actually testify to them on the stand, I was overwhelmed by guilt. And I had been betrayed. I had every reason. I had every reason to testify against them, and no reason at all to feel guilty. But it's that street corner indoctrination, that criminal ethic, that street corner value system, it's overpowering. And I started crying on the stand.
These stories generally are only told by people like Nicky Barnes, people who had already told these stories on the stand, and they're rats. You don't inform all your friends. But at that point there, the guy I knew ceased to exist. For me, the Nick I knew died.
In other words, it's saying that, hey, Nick, you broke the golden rule. And I'm saying, what good is a rule if the rule ain't a jewel that's fit for the crown of a king? If you're gonna take the rule and just use it to make bling, and you're gonna say, fuck the king, then the king gonna sing.
think my information resulted in maybe 75 or 80 felony convictions. They have a place in Lewisburg Federal Penitentiary that they call it the Nicky Barnes Range, because all of the people up there were people that I gave up.
My name is Frank James. I'm calling from Otisville FCI prison in upstate New York, and I'm doing life without parole plus 40 years. I've been down 23 years and 11 months. The worst thing that the government or whoever did it could have done was name him Mr. Untouchable.
I think that when people talk about him, they'll talk more about, they'll talk a little about him being a snitch, but more about him being an ex-drug addict and coming up to reach the heights that he did. The drugs kept the hood from starving. Pushing cars, Nicky Barnes was the 70s, but there's a long list of high-profile celebrities. It's only one thing that's definite about that life that's not gonna last. One time, one day, grasp me as I'm about to blast heat, 40 side of burning. I turn well, he asks me, what you up to? The cops gonna bust you. I was a teen, drunk or brew, stumbled.
I'm like everybody else, you know, my credit cards is maxed out, you know, but I go home every night and I ain't gotta take a different route. And I don't have to have guns at the end of the cushions in my house. And, you know, people can come to my door unannounced now, you know. And people can even know where I live. And I don't have to change my name to take a flight somewhere and do all of those things. So that's the dues that I paid, and that's what I try to pass on to these kids that want to be gangsters. Pre-trial hearing is over, it's real for the soldier. Walks in the courtroom, the look in his eyes is wild. Triple homicide, I sit in the back aisle. I want to crack a smile when
I'm
trying to justify
or rationalize anything, you know, that was taking place in terms of, drugs in the community, violence, any of those things. And, but I think that, and this is my opinion, is that the real criminals in this country, you know, even though the media tends to focus on the ones that are that are at the bottom of the social ladder, the real criminals are at the top.
How are we ever gonna get up if that's how we get down? Shame when you really look at it. My folk against your folk. But we all can folk. Somebody gotta make a change.
I'm still here. Yeah, I'm still here, and I'm still keeping on. You understand? You need to lay down, but you did, you did. You understand? I don't have no love for you, but I don't hate you. Why? I don't know. I wish I could tell you why I don't, but I don't. You understand? I'm not going to wish you bluebirds, you understand? But I'm not going to wish you falcons and buzzards either. Just go ahead, man, and just live your life, whatever you're doing. And just leave us alone. Leave the streets alone. You understand? And if you do have to say something, send a positive word out there to them kids and tell them that what you did was wrong. Tell them that. You understand? Stop trying to relive the life that you had. Because when you really look at it, we didn't.